So how have you been here? A few of you have been here for a couple of years, and some of you are, most of you are new joinees, I believe. Is that a fact that most of you are new joinees here? Most of you are new joinees, right? Those who are nodding their head, I can make out, I can figure out that they are spirited people, full of energy, and looking forward to a great time here, right? I want to ask you general knowledge questions. I will not make any reference to Vijay Vardharajan's, you know, reference here on cyber security, because recently held conference was on cyber security. And Mr. Vijay Vardharajan from university in Australia, which was that, Melbourne or Sydney? Newcastle. Okay, Newcastle University, right? But I still remember, his words are still ringing in my ear. If you do a like on the Facebook, your entire longitude and latitude is taken, and your entire profile can be exposed to the hackers. One simple tick, just a like, and there is like. One posting a photograph on your Facebook profile can be dangerous. So alarming, and he said there's no absolute majority in the cybersecurity space. What an astounding and a very prophetic statement, and so alarming. And we're always glued to the jigmos and the smartphones and the television sets and the laptops and whatnot. And it's taking a very heavy toll of the gray matter which is stored in your skull. You're so rich, but it renders you energyless, powerless, effortless, initiative-less. I would ask you a few questions that are pertaining to the country. Where is Golconda? Please stand up and reply if you know the answer. Where is Golconda, and why is it known as Golconda? I'll name two places belonging to India. The Kolar and the Golconda. And known for what? If any one of you know, then you please come on over the dais and speak from this microphone. And let me also get educated as to how much you know about. What is India's current population? Any one of you updated on figures of India's population? Any guess, any one of you, I mean, aware of the happenings around us, what's happening, why is global warming taking place? None knows how much is your country's population, and at what rate is it growing? The forecast is in 2024, India will make a global mark in population explosion. Will be the most thickly and densely populated country in the world. Will be ahead of China in respect to population. At 1,046,000,000. 1,046,000,000 is your total population at currently. This country will be to the tune of 4 billion population by 2024. At the rate the population rate is rising, it's going to explode, and India is going to having a very distinguished place of being the most populated, and it's going to earn a lot of notoriety. How much of an unemployment in your country? What's the percentage of this 1.46 billion people in this living in this country? How much percentage of people are employed? Do you know that? What's the youth population? What is the youth population? Any statistician here? The people from economics must know what this country's population is and how its economy is growing and what its economy is based on. Whether it's an agrarian economy or what kind of economy it is. Because as such, no industrial revolution has taken place in India. No technological advancement has been made. 56% of this country's population is youth. Am I correct on the figures? If I'm wrong, you can correct me. Yes, please stand and speak. All right, close by, but let me tell you, correct you, it's 56 million people, 56 million youths in this country. And out of this, 26 million people are unemployed youth. The unemployment is growing, and the employed people are not so satisfied with their jobs. Job satisfaction is never 100%. It's relatively good or bad. But then you have some skilled workers, you have some people who are unskilled, you have educated people, you have not so educated people. And you account for just 7% of the privileged ones who could do their masters and qualify to be teachers. So country's population pegged at 1.6 billion today is going to touch 3 point something, that will be approximately 4 billion people living in this country. 56% are youth, 26% are unemployed, and the people who are employed are also not fully satisfied people. Full of frustration, full of agitated minds. Irritability is on a very high scale. Why I'm referring to this is, now where does your GDP go then, if you don't have productive citizens? If you cannot turn every district into a wealth-generating district, if you cannot make enable people, yesterday I was looking at one of the DNA news on the ZTV, gave some figures, alarming figures, at what rate the warming is taking place. In 2020, your temperatures will be hovering around 46 degrees Celsius in Delhi because your vehicle emission and your air conditioning emissions and put together, because what's fitted in an air conditioner is what? What is the most crucial component of the air conditioner? Can anyone of you tell me it stops cooling? What stops in a, what goes wrong with the air conditioner? Compressor. That compresses the air and emits heat and transports, you know, from the environment. It absorbs moisture, separates heat, and the
coal still there. At what cost are you putting on your air conditioners? You don't know. You're contributing to carbon footprints and the alarmingly high temperature rise, which is going to touch around 46. Delhi's population itself will be around 3.6 crores. At the moment, it is 1.37 crores. And still the census go on, and the correct figures have yet to come, and I'm sure the city has outlived its meaning. When did Delhi become India's capital? India's capital was Kolkata earlier. You Ghosh, can you tell me, because Kolkata ceased to be the capital of India. In the year 1911, the capital of India shifted from Kolkata to Delhi. And then the Lutyens' Delhi was planned. Lutyens was the architect. It was an imperial city. You know how much population? It started 5 lakhs population to 911. And then started growing, and it becomes a slum, you know, dwellers, you know, city. The economically backward people, their aspirations and hopes, they migrate from remote places in Bihar and Uttar Pradesh, they come in search of job and employment, they come to Delhi, they settle here, and they are a strain on our civic infrastructure. Delhi is dependent for its environment, whether it's going to be a hot climate or it's going to be a cold climate, it's purely dependent on Rajasthan's heat wave. It comes, Delhi gets heated up. If there's a northwesterly wind blowing and sweeping Delhi, it can become cold, start shivering. Delhi does not have natural resources of its own. Now, who is going to tap these natural resources? When I refer to Golconda, is a mine from where Kohinoor was taken. It was dug up and mined. And it's in the crown of the Prince Elizabeth of England. Then India had a lot of litigation in the International Court of Justice. And they got a part of it in the National Museum. If you go, a part of that Kohinoor is also displayed here. At that time, it was very, very heavy, the heaviest diamond, which was found, that it was fitted in the crest jewel of the British Empire. And they ruled us because of the supremacy of their intellect. Now, how are you going to compete? How are we going to beat these challenges? Golconda is known for the Kohinoor diamond. So the miners went down the Mother Earth, they caved in, they dug out a diamond. First it was black. Then it was brought out, chiseled and polished, and then it became ornament. It had an ornamental value. Kolar mines are known for gold. In 1 ton of the soil that you dug up, you get 1 kg gold. Kolar mines are sick today. The Golconda mines have stopped mining, because you don't have the trained, mechanized manpower, the technological supremacy to mine, to dig up these mines mechanically and take out the
this stuff from where you can separate the black diamond and the white diamond you can separate. We are a mineral-rich country, and so are your brains, like mines, those mines. Brilliant mines, brilliant minerals dumped here in our brain. The brightest of ideas. But who is going to do that mining, self-auditing, self-introspection? I'm just telling you what this country is, all in all its manifestation. I mean, it's diverse cultures and everything, and then we all converging and making India a country of our dreams. But none of us as a citizen is discharging our duties, fundamental rights we want to claim, but we are not aware of the corresponding duties with each one of the fundamental rights. You don't have a right to spit on the roads. You don't have a right to litter the roads. You don't have the freedom to speak anything that you want to speak. Even freedom to speak also is with certain conditionalities that you will not deliver an inflammatory speech, which might incite violence. Why I'm telling you coal or gold mines and the Golconda, it may not have any reference to the context, but let me tell you, you need to mine your minds. You need to explore the beauty of your mind. You need to look within, introspect, bring the brightest of your talent and the knowledge, duly refreshed. A teacher who has ceased to learn is no teacher. We have done our doctoral research. We have done our dissertation. We brought a huge thesis, put it before the interview selection committee members, show them this is what you have worked on. But when it comes to its application, in India's context, it is not relevant. It just qualifies you to hold a doctoral degree just for an ornamental thing. You're doctor such and such, and you're doctor such and such. But then, what use is it to my country? How is it enriching my country? How is it empowering my country? The empowerment, the information has to be converted into knowledge. Knowledge has to be converted into wisdom. Wisdom has got to be converted into something valuable that should contribute towards the growth of my country, towards my individual growth, and to the country's growth as a whole. Can we question ourselves? Are we instruments of growth? Are we instruments of prosperity? Are we an instrument of prosperity? Are we in any case contributing towards a pool of knowledge which is useful not to us, not to the neighbor, but to the society and to the country as a whole? And I get the whole thing patented. How many patents an Indian scientist's name you can just count, do a head count? It's a very, very sad story. The Nobel laureates, they come from Western European countries. And we have, if at all, we have made it in the past, maybe in literature or maybe in peace, that too being shared by our neighbor country. We never had the honor and the privilege to go to Oslo and get that coveted award, which is called Nobel Prize. Amritsar Shane is just one, and then we keep on hopping one or more, two, and maybe four, five, or seven. And in countries, They get in physics, they get in chemistry, they get in maths. They get it in biotechnology, they get in the new fields of actuarial sciences, they get in economics, and that benefits not only the country, but it's a global harvest. It's a global harvest. So let you not stay within the confines of this skull, but become thinkers. From your basic thinking, must come concern for this country. How can I contribute towards the growth of education first, empower people, and enable them to get employed so that the rate of unemployment in this country, which is now, can in any case be minimized? Because if you are not imparting skills, if you are not imparting the knowledge which is applied knowledge, you are reading IPC, you are reading CRPC, you are criminal jurisprudence, you are teaching anything and everything under the globe. But then when one goes to the court, sits like a duck because he cannot draft a legal drafting, he's poor. His English is poor, he's poor in literature. Programming you cannot do. We don't create applications. How many applications India has created and how many applications have been created by people sitting in the Silicon Valley, Pichai there. And anybody you talk about, billion brain drain took place. And they are all sitting pretty in their homes and keep cursing their country. They say India is a damn country. We need not go back there. More of brain drain is taking place. Well, the people are educating their children to settle down in Stanford and the Cornell and the Princeton and the Harvard, and then they have a title. My son is there and he's settled there. Then they go. I've seen families migrating to US, migrating to Australia, migrating to New Zealand. There was one doctor from Maharashtra. He is now a professor in pharmacology in New Zealand. Left the cool environment at Palampur Agricultural University, Ravi Tehlan. And he went there, Telang. Ravi Telang, his name. I keep speaking to him. He said, what a difference between environment here and there. It's because we have not been able to cultivate responsible citizenship. Subsidies are being passed. Excise duty is being cut to subsidize the petrol prices and the diesel prices. We are trying to do that kind of exercise. Not that we try and explore oil. We ask ONGC to step up its own oil exploration so that we are self-reliant in oil. We don't have to import the crude. And most of it is not fully bargained, but because for various defense reasons or for any other reason, it is not bargained. Else it would have cost cheaper. Governments come and they give you soaps, you know. You take this, you take that, give one lollipop or the other, keep you busy with that for 5 years, and the government comes. And then a new governance in the name of governance, good governance. Then again, country's economy starts sliding. Thoughtlessly, few financial reforms are introduced. Anyway, I'll remain contextual as the research should be contextual. So I'm coming back to what a teacher should be. A teacher has to be a learner all the time. If any one of you has unmindfully closed your books, old books, please remove that dust. Open them again and again. Read those books. Refresh your knowledge. Update yourself in your respective fields.
or else you'll get become irrelevant, no more relevant. I had the privilege of having a gold card in the Asia 82 games. Many of you may not have been born, or many of you may have been infants, and when the Asia 82 games were hosted for the first time, and we have not yet been able to create another stadium of Jawaharlal Nehru Stadium capacity with 1 lakh and plus. I was a gold card holder, I was a member of the Doping Commission, and I could see the wisdom from the Upanishads being translated there. How the Upanishads' wisdom came alive there. It says, Yastu Sarvani Bhutani, Yastu Sarvani Bhutani, Atmani Vara Anupashyati, Sarva Bhuteshu Cha Atmanam, Sarva Bhuteshu Cha Atmanam, Tato Na Vijgupsate, Yasmin Sarvani Bhutani, Atmano Bhut Vijanata. Vijanata means he becomes the scientist, becomes the knower, the ultimate knower of a knowledge. Yasmin Sarvani Bhutani, Atmano Bhut Vijanata, तत्र को मोह को शोक एकत्व न पश्यते एकत्व का दर्शन करता है दैट वननेस ऑफ ऑल मैनकाइंड ऑफ द एंटायर ह्यूमैनिटी इन सफरिंग यू आर वन व्हाइल रिजॉइसिंग यू आर वन एंड आई कोट यू एन एग्जांपल व्हेन गीता देन दैट उषा पीटी उषा वाज ऑन द ट्रैक ए लेक हार्ट बीट्स came to a pause while she was on the starting line. She was there and she made her entry and she got a applause, and then all the heartbeats came for a stop for a while, and I waited with a bated breath what's going to happen, because country's prestige was involved. And as she started running on the track, our heart started pounding. And a moment came when there was a applause, thunderous applause in the entire auditorium, and each one of us stood on our feet. Well done, Usha. And none of us were Usha. But we identified ourselves, we transcended our limited self and identified with her accomplishment of getting a gold at the Asia. She became the first golden, sprinter girl to have that distinction, the honor. And then every Indian felt proud. Where did your limited self shrunk at that time? Where did it evaporate? None of us could see the difference. We saw as if we have been honored. Then came a moment which was the height of the moment when she stood on the pedestal, and then the first, gold was put around her neck, gold medal, and the national anthem was played. What an honor. What a joy. What a moment. And that joy was not restricted to one individual self. All the 1 lakh people sitting in a packed auditorium, their hearts were enthralled. We were all enthralled. We were all applauding. We were all jumping in joy. Why? How does it happen? You have to learn the science of transcending your limited self and go beyond and identify yourself with somebody else's pain and the suffering and the love and affection that they are waiting to dispense and share with you. But you are living in your limited cocoons, self-limiting your knowledge. You could have become knowledge giants, living transmitters. You would have transmitted positive vibes. Then most of people, after they have read anything, intellectualism comes. The wisdom doesn't dawn on them.
that they are still a learner, a student, and they should keep on learning and refreshing their knowledge so that the water in a pool, you know, once becomes stagnant, it has a stench. You want a fresh water. You will never ever take a stagnant water. You will not take from one pool which is stagnant, where there's a regular flow of water. The flowing water is known as river. From a rivulet, you will enjoy taking fresh, cool water, but then you will not like to take it from a pond, which is a cesspool, which has been rotting. Degeneration of human mind taking place. This is the most disastrous thing that can happen, which is happening now. Most of you, come on, I've done my thing. Now I've got an employment, and I can afford to rest on my laurels, and I may not do anything. Now I can lead a very comfortable life, dictate terms to my spouse, browbeat homes, shout at the top of your voice, standing on a higher pedestal, I'm a scholar. Please be modest. Please be humble. God has been very kind to you that you got educated, that you didn't grow in impoverishment. Never ever become selfish. This message of the Upanishad is universal. Become one, and that oneness, and the students who come to you, you should feel privileged that you have been bestowed that honor, that respect of a teacher who is sought for knowledge, for wisdom. And they look for every question and answer from the teacher. The expectations are like that. We as managers here, people are part of the management, me and Ajay ji and Vineet ji and everybody else here, everyone is contributing. You be the stakeholders of tomorrow. Let this institution grow and become stakeholders. Let the students become stakeholders. Let it multiply. Let it not remain just one VIPS. Let there be many VIPS in the rest of the part of the country. Let's be inspired by that philosophy of oneness of mankind, which Fritz of Capra very aptly put it to Kane Wibbler, another Nobel Prize winner, and he says, our scientists need to be Buddhas. Or else, without the holistic vision of oneness of mankind, the rational science is going to destroy civilization. Oneness of mankind, the other's pain is your pain. The other's suffering is your suffering. Make others comfortable. Make them feel happy. Add joy, instill hope in them. No dejection. Come with that energy. And go with that lesson, that philosophy of the wisdom that has come down the millennium, handed down the millennium to us, that oneness of mankind. Serve God in man. There cannot be a greater embodiment of God. Man is the greatest manifestation of the divinity. Manifest the divinity within by controlling nature, external as well as internal. You may do it by work, worship, psychic control, by philosophy, or maybe by more than one, but you have to be free from the bondages of ignorance. Each one of us is ignorant. We don't know where are we, in which direction are we going. Is that the correct direction, is that the wrong direction, or is that no direction? Most of the people are going directionless. Let's explore and implore. Let's look within and try to impart the best of knowledge
empower our citizens, future generations, do something for the posterity to come so that they can say, well done, you have made a very prosperous country. You have made a country which is free, which has a clean air, where you can see this blue sky and count the stars. You can be a stargazer. Daily it's not possible, because each one of us want to live in air conditioner comforts. Switching off an air conditioner makes us restless, breathless. Please contribute by switching off your air conditioners, by switching off your ignition, by not driving in too many vehicles, not to buy too many vehicles. How many lakh vehicles? 76 lakh vehicles on Delhi roads. 76 lakh vehicles. And that vehicle emission and the emission from your air conditioners is contributing towards warming of our climate. Climate changes are taking place. May I appeal to you as teachers to remain teachers and to remain learners all the time. My message is this. And once you have outlived your utility, you will be thrown out. I am no more redundant. So what's the way to stay in form? Because such and such sports person is the best of all in form by such and such year and date. Now that doctor and athlete and or engineer has lost his form or her form. What is that form? Staying in form and being out of form. What is it? Staying in form and out of form. You can only stay in form when in touch with the live wire. The moment your connection is cut from the live wire, you're dead and gone. You're stopped to grow. Staying in touch with the live wire, with the divine message of oneness of mankind, let's not work for our individual growth. Let's work for our inclusive growth, for the growth of all. Atmano mokshartam jagat hitaye cha. Let's not only work for our own salvation, but for everybody's salvation from the bondages of poverty, impoverishment, from the bondages of ignorance. Asto ma sadgamaya, tamso ma jyotirgamaya, mrityor ma amritam gamaya. Lead me from the unreal to real. Lead me from darkness to light. Lead me from death to immortality is the eternal prayer of the Vedas. Awaken yourself. Manifest the divinity within you. Live in touch with the live wire, and you will never become a teacher out of form. You will always stay teachers in form, updated and refreshed. Thank you.